Okay, Marcus, thanks again for the introduction. It's actually a great pleasure. Looking at the lineup of speakers, it's a great pleasure to kick off this this fantastic workshop this morning, or maybe this afternoon, depending on where you're connecting from. The goal for today on my side is to tell you about ongoing work, really trying to go beyond SLAM, simultaneous localization and mapping, and towards spatial perception and high-level understanding for robotics. So this great work, the credit goes to my students who are pushing hard like on these topics, including Tony, Marcus, Arjun, Yun, Nathan, Jingnan, and Andrew. So the plan for today is to cover two big topics. The first one is Chimera, which is our attempt to go from SLAM to metric semantic mapping. And then the second part is going to be about 3D dynamic scene graphs, which is a way to get from metric semantic mapping to high level understanding. So let me start with Chimera. And I guess a good way to start here is just to look back at the progress made by the robotics community in SLAM over the last two decades. We must be really proud of the things that as a community we achieved over the last two decades. So it's enough to look at the great implementation of feature-based SLAM, such as ORB SLAM, to direct methods for denser reconstruction, such as DSO, to more recent implementation using newer sensors, such as even cameras. And these algorithms not only are starting to work very well with great implementations out there, but they're also starting to steadily transition into products, including Skyview, for example. We're going to hear about that in a second, virtual reality goggles, startups, and so on. So this great, great progress. At the same time, we have to realize that there is still a large gap between robot and human perception. So with robots, through SLAM, we have been able to get sparse or dense representation of the environment, let's say point clouds, object-based maps, collection of primitives such as lines, voxel, meshes, and so on. But human perception is much more than that. And I need just one picture to convince you that this is the case. If you look at this single frame for a few seconds, as a human, you can look at a single frame and just understand what is the geometry. This is a street with buildings. You can understand the presence of objects. You can understand the semantics of objects. For example, you can understand that yellow cars are specific type of cars, which are essentially taxi. And you can also reason about relations among different objects in the scene. You can understand that one car is behind the other one, or maybe some of the people, like, you know, on the sidewalk, they're trying to cross the street. So this kind of high-level understanding is still out of reach for robotics. But let me say, why do we care about high-level understanding in the first place? Well, high-level understanding is key to interaction. Personally, if I have to envision robotics in 20 years or even in 10 years, I don't want to tell my robot, go to position X, Y, and Z. I want the robot to have a complex understanding of the environment such that I can issue high-level commands such as, robot, go and grab me a cup of coffee. I think a nice example is imagining, like, you know, picturing a future Alexa, Amazon Alexa, in which I can ask Alexa, Alexa, where did I leave my coffee mug? And this future Alexa is so smart and so clever about spatial understanding that we'll be able to answer, the coffee mug is on the table near the window in the dining room. And you can understand that such an answer is really, like, you know, describing a lot of spatial understanding of the geometry and semantics of things in the scene. High-level understanding is more than just enabling the interaction. In my opinion, high-level understanding is key to robust perception. And I'm trying to give you, like, you know, to tease this idea through a single slide. If I think about an object in isolation, I look at this slide and I see a car. But if I look at the full picture from which I cropped the image of the car, as a human, you can look at this picture and you can realize that actually there is no car in the scene. There is a car painted on a van, but there is actually just a van in the scene. And probably your mental model has been something like you detected the ground, you detected the car, you detected the van, and then you reason on the fact that the car and the van cannot be physically at the same location, so one must be painted on the other. So in other words, what I'm saying here is that robust perception relies on simultaneously understanding geometry, semantics, physics, and relations in 3D. So in the next few slides, I'm going to tell you the effort that we have been making in giving or making progress in giving high-level understanding to robots. And the first step is about giving robots the capability to reason about geometric and semantic aspects in the scene. So this is the work we made about Chimera. Chimera is an open source real-time library for metric, semantic, simultaneous localization and mapping. And Chimera is taking input from a standard camera, essentially camera frames, as well as IMU data. And as output, Chimera is producing a metric semantic 3D mesh. So what you see here, you see the first person view on the left and the top view on the right is a 3D mesh, right? But the colors of the each phase of the mesh, they are not real colors, they are semantic labels. So for example, dark green corresponds to the walls, or gray corresponds to the ground, yellow are the cubicles, green are the chairs, and so on. And this is something that you can try for yourself. We have a very fast open source implementation on GitHub. So what I want to do in the next few slides is to tell you about the key building blocks in Chimera. And I also want to tell you about new modules that we just added to Chimera and you might not have seen before. So Chimera includes three key modules, we can see. So Chimera is taking data from a camera, an IMU system. There is Chimera Visual Inertial Odometry, VIU, which is the first module. The VIU is getting into the robust PostGraph optimization, which is getting a globally consistent trajectory estimate. And then Chimera Semantics is in charge of getting this nice metric semantic reconstruction. So quickly, I will tell you about each block. So the VIU is essentially looking at visual inertial data, is extracting features from the images, and is solving an optimization problem to reconstruct the 3D location of these features, as well as a trajectory estimate for the robot, which has no prior knowledge of the environment before starting. And this is based on an idea that the pre-integration theory that actually we developed with Davide, Frank, and Christian back in 2015. So it is using pre-integration factor, which are also implemented in GTSM to enable fast and robust visual inertial odometry. Of course, as we all know, as roboticists, we all know that odometry somehow, like, you know, will always drift over time. So if you just consider the odometric estimate, which is the one in red here, this will tend to accumulate error over time. So it's important to detect loop closures and correct the trajectory using these loop closures. This detection of loop closure and correction is something that is done in Chimera RPGO, robust PostGraph optimization. And I would say that there is nothing new here in terms of loop closure detection. We just use bag of words plus ORB descriptors, which is pretty much the same as done in ORB SLAM. The new idea is really about using robust techniques, modern techniques for robust PostGraph optimization, which are able to reject bad loop closures. And you can see that this makes a difference. If we don't do outlier rejection, if we don't do robust loop closure optimization, we get trajectories which are really noisy, right? Because we have outliers in the loop closures. If instead we include the technique for outlier rejection, we get smooth trajectories because we are able to detect the few very good loop closures along the trajectory. And the last module is Chimera Semantics, which is, again, given the trajectory in particular, the VIU trajectory is going to reconstruct this nice 3D mesh. So for the geometric reconstruction, we rely on Boxblocks, which is an excellent library from ETH. What we add on top of that is the semantics. So we use 2D semantic segmentation, which is something that you can get with a neural network nowadays. And we use a fast ray tracing approach to back project the 2D segmentation into the 3D mesh. And this is something that Andrew Davison was doing back in 2016 with Semantic Fusion. I guess the novelty here is that we're trying to do this on CPU using fast and approximate ray casting, which is running at around 10 Hertz on a standard CPU. I want to spend the last few minutes about talking about Chimera, telling you about a new block, new module that we actually just included in Chimera, which is called Chimera PGMO, PostGraph and Mesh Deformation. So just to give you some context, I already mentioned that Chimera VIU will actually drift over time, and the drift is corrected using loop closure and robust PostGraph optimization. So the picture that you can have is that there is the automatic trajectory, which is drifting. And thanks to the loop closure part, we kind of correct this trajectory. The issue, however, is that the 3D mesh that we build is built from the VIU estimate. So what happens is that the mesh itself will kind of drift over time because it's built from the VIO estimate. So while we're able to correct the trajectory of the robot, the mesh will get worse and worse over time. And the question that we try to address with this module is, how do we make the 3D mesh globally consistent? So this is something that we presented for the first time in the extended journal version of the Chimera paper. It's something that we put on archive like, you know, a few months ago, and you can find all the details over there. But I can give you just the flavor of what we did to fix the mesh. So the approach is based on an idea from computer graphics, which is called the deformation graph. And it is pretty simple. So we have the trajectory of the robot, we have the mesh, and out of this, we create a deformation graph where we include all the poses along the trajectory of the robot, as well as local poses, which are defining local reference frames attached to the mesh at a subset of vertices of the mesh. So we have a sparse set of poses attached to the mesh. And the basic idea is that after you have this set of poses, we also establish edges corresponding to, let's say, relation trying to enforce local rigidity of the mesh or of the mesh with respect to the trajectory. And after a loop closure is detected, what we do is that instead of just optimizing the trajectory of the robot, we try to optimize at the same time the poses attached to the mesh and the trajectory itself, resulting in a simultaneous correction of the trajectory estimate as well as the mesh reconstruction. And I think this is probably the first time in which there is a kind of a joint formulation between pose graph and mesh deformation. And it's kind of nice because in the paper, we show that mathematically, actually the optimization you do to build and to optimize the deformation graph is nothing else than pose graph optimization, which means that you can use, I don't know, 15 years of research, 20 years of research on pose graph optimization to make this optimization very, very fast. The result, I think, is well described by this animation here. What you see here is that is a top view of the map created by robot. The robot is starting over there, is moving around, and is coming back to a loop closure here. And you can see that at the time of the loop closure, the map is kind of jumping around because we are correcting the mesh in response to the loop closure. And on the right-hand side here, you see an example, two examples of 3D reconstructions, which are color-coded by the error, the reconstruction error. And you see that on the top, there are dark areas corresponding to areas with large errors. And this is what happens before the deformation with Chimera PGMO. After you apply the deformation, the dark areas are just disappearing, meaning that you reduce the error in the reconstruction. And at the level of the architecture, you can think about PGMO as a replacement for the PostGraph optimization module in Chimera. So we spent some time, and we're still doing that. We spent some time, like, you know, over the last year doing extensive testing in Chimera. So we tried multiple data sets, including real data sets from UROC to data sets collected at, you know, apartment scenes, schools, at MIT. We have a very nice photorealistic simulator that we use for testing across a variety of scenarios. And to be honest, we just tried Chimera, like, you know, on all possible robots from sensor rigs that we put together at MIT, the Euroc drone, of course, self-driving car platforms, Husky robots, Jackal robots in the context of different projects. And we're trying to get Chimera better and better, like, you know, and to make it more robust to real world conditions. I invite you to go to the journal version of the paper because it contains all the results. I will just give you, like, you know, one slide summary of the result, but I think it's, you know, fair assessment is that Chimera VIO, which is the visual inertial odometry, is achieving state-of-the-art performance in VIO, getting, like, you know, a drift which is around 0.2% of the trajectory. I would say is not better, is in the same ballpark as very good implementation, including BinsMon or OpenBins. But on top of that, we have this clever, robust loop closure approach, which is more robust to bad loop closures, as well as the PostGraph and mesh optimization, which is able to improve the quality of the 3D metric semantic reconstruction. I don't want you to spend too much time looking at the table. This is estimation trajectory errors. So the lower, the better. And you can see that the VIO on the UROC datasets is achieving smallest error, but I would say in general is in the same ballpark as Vince Mono and OpenVince, while the PGMO is also achieving good, very good errors in response to loop closures. And Chimera is running, we have a very fast multi-threaded implementation, is running on three separate threads. And these are the runtime statistics. There are slow threads, which are doing, for example, PostgreSQL optimization. And there are fast threads, which instead are doing the front-end part of SLAM. And everything is running like in a matter of milliseconds. So everything is running at frame rate. Okay, so let me use the last 5 minutes of this presentation to jump to the next step, which is building on top of Chimera and is getting to this idea of 3D dynamic scene graphs. It's getting towards high level understanding. So we'll jump right in and show you what is a 3D dynamic scene graph. 3D dynamic scene graph is a hierarchical model, hierarchical representation of the environment in which at the lowest level, we have a traditional map for SLAM. We have, for example, a 3D mesh or a 3D metric semantic mesh as in Chimera. But there are also multiple layers which are describing different portions of the environment. For example, layer 2 is about objects and agents in the environment. Layer 3 is about places and structures. So places are essentially a topological map of the environment, while structures are walls, ceiling, and so on. And if you go up, you will get rooms, buildings, and so on. So it's really a hierarchy hierarchical description of the environment itself. More formally, a 3D dynamic scene graph is a directed graph where nodes are spatial concepts. So anything that is grounded in space, objects, rooms, humans, and ages represent spatio-temporal relations between concepts. For example, agent I is in room J at time T, or object one is close to object two, for example. So the key insight here is to describe the environment at different level of abstraction, capture dynamic elements in the scene, such as humans or other robots, and include actionable information for planning. I already mentioned that the places are essentially a topological map, which enables very fast planning. So this is our RSS paper, and there is also the extended journal version of this. But in the paper, rather than just proposing the representation, we also design algorithms to build a 3D dynamic scene graph from visual inertial data in crowded environments. And I think what we are proposing really is that we have to move on from SLAM algorithms to what we call spatial perception engines, which are algorithms that infer the geometry, the semantics, and a hierarchy of high-level spatial concepts and their relations. I will not tell you everything about how to build the scene graph, but I will give you just the pitch about the key layers here. So in layer one, the metric semantic mesh is essentially the output of Chimera with some extra cleverness about avoiding to integrate moving obstacles or humans in the 3D reconstruction. So we keep them separate. The objects and agent layer, I think, is one of the coolest one. Essentially, we're able to do by combining deep learning pose estimation for humans with traditional robust PostgreSQL optimization, we're able to reconstruct in real time these dense mesh models of humans working in the environment. And I believe this is pretty much the first example of full 3D reconstruction of humans done in conjunction to dense mapping and SLAM in very large environments. And here you can see the resulting tracks and trajectories of the humans. For the objects, we have simple algorithms for objects for which we don't know the shape, like Euclidean clustering, and we have more clever algorithms for objects for which you have a CAD model, and in particular, we have a long line of research on certifiable algorithms for object detection, and you can take a look at the papers for that. Places and structure are essentially doing a Voronoi diagram based on a library. This is, again, great library from ETH, to extract a topological map of the environment as a graph of places with ages describing collision-free trajectories in the environment. And on top of that, we also extract rooms, which are essentially doing a clustering algorithm on the graph of places to isolate the different rooms in the environment that you see here in the animation being color-coded, okay? So this is a graph, and we leverage the Euclidean science distance function to cluster this graph in multiple rooms. And buildings, there is not much to be done. We're doing single building reconstruction for now. So we'll take this slide to just give you a zoomed in version of the 3D dynamic scene graph, and in particular on layer 2 of the scene graph, which is objects and humans. this is not quite real time right now. So everything that runs in Chimera, the metric semantic reconstruction is real time. The construction of the full scene graph happens at the end of the run. It takes around like 30 minutes to reconstruct. We are working on a real-time implementation, but is currently offline. Results in real scenes, results in simulation, and since I'm out of time, I will just jump to the conclusion. So the point of this presentation is that there is still a large gap separating robot and human perception, and we just need to bridge this gap and go beyond SLAM and think about real-time 3D high-level understanding. Towards this goal, I presented two early steps, towards the goal of high-level understanding. First one is Chimera, which is a metric semantic real-time SLAM library, which is modular and open source. And I tried to tell you about a few recent things about PostgreSQL and mesh optimization, testing, and a ticker we presented the multi-robot version of Chimera. And also presented these 3D dynamic scene graphs, which I believe are an expressive and general representation for robot perception in dynamic scenes. There are a bunch of things which are new about scene graphs, including the use of graph neural networks for scene graphs, real-time implementation and applications, but I was not able to squeeze them in a 20-minute presentation. So this being said, I will thank the students doing the hard work behind this presentation, thanking the sponsor, and just thanking all of you for your attention. And if you're curious to learn more, just feel free to connect to the YouTube channel of the lab.